Okay. Welcome everyone to the 24th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Support Committee in 2022. I have received apologies from the convener this morning. The first item of the agenda is to decide whether to take items 6, 7 and 8 in private today and whether to take the next meeting on the 6th of September 2022 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you very much. Our second item is our final evidence session as part of our inquiry into health inequalities. And I welcome to the committee Marie Todd, the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport. And she is soon to be joined by Michael Kellett, the Director of Population Health for the Scottish Government. I will now invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement. Minister.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener, for inviting me to give evidence today to this inquiry. I'm aware that my officials in Public Health Scotland took part in a private session with you all last month where they outlined the range of work we are all undertaking in Scotland to support a reduction in health inequalities. I was very pleased to hear that you found the session useful. We have indeed made many positive changes. However, I want to be upfront about the challenges that we all face on this issue. Scotland's long-standing health inequalities are fundamentally about income, wealth and poverty. The recent report from the University of Glasgow and the Glasgow Centre for Population Health attributes stalling life expectancy trends in Scotland directly to UK-led austerity measures. The report makes a number of key recommendations, including protecting the real incomes of the poorest groups, especially with current escalating inflation rates. Their evidence strongly suggests that implementing such measures would reverse death rates and reduce the widening health inequalities we are seeing. We are doing all we can to mitigate the impact of such policies. The introduction, for example, of the Scottish Child Payment of £20 per week is just one of the measures that we are taking to mitigate the adverse impact of UK government-led reforms and put money back in the pockets of those hit hardest. We have over 200 community link workers across Scotland playing a vital role by supporting people with issues such as debt, as well as social isolation and housing. And our welfare advice and health partnerships are now well embedded in 150 GP surgeries in Scotland's most deprived areas. However, we simply do not have all of the levers at our disposal to tip the balance and change the trajectory of life expectancy. I have stressed in previous debates and sessions that this Parliament needs to be a public health Parliament where all parties come together to consider how we jointly tackle these issues. Our work on child poverty provides us with an opportunity to live up to that expectation. It's a national mission, and our commitment to wide-ranging action is demonstrated by the work taking place across portfolios looking at outcomes for children and young people. This includes a collective focus on what we're doing in childcare, what we're doing to support people into work, and what we're doing to support those furthest away from the labour market. None of this is easy, and we're learning as we go, but this is precisely the kind of approach that we need to help address health inequalities across all of the social determinants of health. And as part of the strategic reform of health, our emerging care and wellbeing portfolio is creating a sustainable health and social care system that will promote new and innovative ways of working. This includes our Place and Wellbeing programme, which is bringing together all sectors to jointly drive change locally to reduce health inequalities. An example of this is our work to position NHS and social care providers as anchor institutions within our communities, working with others such as housing associations, local government and universities to nurture the conditions for health and wellbeing. NHS and social care providers are significant sectors in Scotland and across Scotland. They're well placed to provide opportunities within local communities through increasing access to employment in health and care and making available to communities NHS land and buildings to support their health and wellbeing. Our role is to enable local change, not to dictate what form that takes. And the voice of those with lived experience will be crucial to guide and shape local action on health inequalities. To reiterate, we have all got a collective responsibility to address health inequalities. It is not the sole responsibility for health and social care. I'm committed to playing my role in that endeavour, and I know that there is a real appetite for change amongst us all. That consensus and support is both welcome and necessary, and I am pleased that we are having an open and honest discussion on the subject. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. We are now going to obviously move to questions on a variety of themes in terms of some of the issues that you've covered in your opening remarks. And I'm going to start this morning just in terms of the progress we're making on health inequalities. Now, I appreciate the Minister has kind of covered in her opening remarks the progress of perhaps the past 7 year period. And I think has pointed to, you know, some of the reasons for poor health inequality or poor health equality, if you like, in terms of UK government decision making and austerity. But I wonder if I can just broaden that out a little more. Why does the Minister think we have been unable to make greater progress in addressing health inequalities over a 7 year period, notwithstanding the issue that she has raised? And essentially, what more do we need to do in terms of making progress?
So I thank the convener for that question. I mean, I will focus very much on what the Scottish Government can do, but I don't think we can ignore the, and I've said this before in front of this committee, that it feels like I'm working with one hand tied behind my back. What the Scottish Government gives with one hand, the UK Government takes away with the other. It is a very unwelcome reality that health inequalities are widening, including the gap in healthy life expectancy. And, you know, that's completely unacceptable, and we know we need to do more, particularly on the implementation gap. We recognise that addressing the wider determinants of health, such as poverty and inequality, requires that cross-government working and partner-led action. The answers to health inequality aren't simply in my portfolio in public health. Where potential levers for tackling poverty are reserved, we will continue to put pressure on the UK government on the need to rethink its social and welfare policies, for example, which absolutely help poverty to persist. And we are introducing extra social security programmes which are well beyond anything that the UK government offers. We know we have lots still to do to tackle the determinants of health, where we have control of the levers, and we are making progress in lots of key policy areas. Let me give you just an example of some around the Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. That puts money into the pockets of families now, helping to tackle the cost of living crisis, setting a course for sustainable reductions in child poverty by 2030. I've already mentioned the game-changing Scottish Child Payment, which is £20, and it will increase to £25 when it is increased, when it's extended to cover under-16s by the end of this year. Also, our five family benefits, including the Scottish Child Payment, will be worth up to a maximum of over £10,000 by the time a first child turns six, £9,700 for subsequent children. We've also extended our fuel and security fund by making available a further £10 million to the third sector organisations to support those facing fuel insecurity. This means we've allocated over £1 billion since 2009 to tackling fuel poverty and to improving energy efficiency. I have to say, though, that that particular policy area does highlight the challenges for the Scottish Government in fully tackling these issues. My constituency in Caithness, Sutherland and Ross, it's the furthest north mainland constituency in Scotland, and we pay the highest prices for our electricity. We pay more for our electricity than people down here in the Central Belt do. And that's despite the fact that we are net producers of green energy, and that is despite the fact that we are largely off gas grid. So electricity is a really important source of energy for us. That is fully reserved to the UK government, and it is a UK government policy choice to continue that injustice. I have written to the Chancellor, I think, on my constituency basis, I think about 6 weeks ago, and I haven't even had the courtesy of a response yet. So they have no interest in fixing these appalling injustices, which mean that so many of my constituents, where I live in Scotland, are living in extreme fuel poverty, entirely caused by a UK government policy choice.
I thank the Minister for that initial response. I wonder if I can go a little further in exploring some of the policies and some of the objectives I think that we can move forward in terms of addressing health inequalities. Last week we had some quite compelling evidence from Professor Sir Michael Marmot, who has given evidence to this committee before about the measures that his work, I think, have taken in England, particularly in Wolverhampton and Manchester, around his Marmot Cities model. He has six approaches, essentially, which can make a fundamental difference and have been proven through the reports from those cities to make a difference. Now, I think last week I said they aren't rocket science. They're things that we probably would all recognise as being important things to do that make a difference. These things, though, I think very often are offered and supported by local government and by third sector. We know that funding is reducing and is challenging. So I suppose I'm keen to get the Minister's sense of how we move forward a Marmot Cities agenda in Scotland, particularly with our city regions, and how we might help sustain funding into in these six areas that Professor Marmot has identified.
Well, first of all, let me say that we in the Scottish Government, we really welcome Professor Marmot's work. We're very interested in his approach and his thoughts on how we tackle these thorny issues. They're not easy for any government to tackle and resolve, frankly. We do need to work, and you talk about the powers being largely in local authority and third sector hands. We do need to work really closely with partners. I mentioned that in my introduction. It is really significantly important that we all work together with the same aim. I always think of health inequalities as being a golden thread that should run through all of our work as public sector. Professor Marmot, I think, is actually coming to meet with Scottish Government officials. And I'll let my colleague Michael tell you a little bit more about that. We're so interested in the work that he's doing and keen to learn from him that we've asked him to come and spend some time with government officials. So I'll let Mr. Kellett fill you in on that.
Thanks, Minister. Thanks, Gavina. First of all, I should apologise for feeling like I was here on time and was sitting in the reception in Parliament. So apologies to you, Convener, and to the committee. Yes, had I not been here this morning, given evidence, I would have been in a virtual session with Michael Marmot, with fellow colleagues, official colleagues from Health and Social Care and beyond in government, hearing directly from him, being challenged by him. We are explaining to him the Place and Wellbeing programme, the Care and Wellbeing portfolio that the Minister set out. And we are really interested in his Marmot Cities approach. That a place-based approach is fundamental to the Place and Wellbeing programme that the Minister set out about partnerships with public sector, but also the third sector and potentially private and independent sector as well in localities about how inequalities can best be tackled. So we want to learn those lessons, and I think there's real potential in them. Clearly, the context is different in Scotland, but there's certainly learning there that we want to take. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think it is good to hear that meeting is taking place today and there is progress in terms of that work, because I think committee felt very strongly about that evidence. I wonder if finally, in terms of my contribution, I can just ask about health inequalities that are driven by poverty. Committee heard evidence from many organisations that the only proven policy in relation to poverty and its impact has been, to some extent, the child payment and the progress that's been made around that. Because I think of that direct income going to the poorest families in our society. Would the Minister support a further increase to the child payment in order to tackle those inequalities?
Well, we have committed to a further increase. So we've committed to increasing it to £25 by the end of this year and also to extending those families who are eligible to be available to all children and up to the age of 16 by the end of this year. So that is a further increase. It is, I agree, an extremely helpful way to get money into pockets, but relying on Social Security alone isn't the only thing that we can do. And we do need to... I mean, you know, again, my frustration at not having the levers available to us, and all of the levers that could be available to us will show we really would benefit from being able to have some of the powers over employment law, which would mean that we could ensure that work pays. You know, we live in, we've just seen just a couple of weeks ago with the white paper from the government, looking at Scotland within the UK and comparing ourselves to a number of near European neighbours, we live in a very unequal country. We have a large income gap. We have a very large gender pay gap. There's only one of our close neighbours that has a larger one. We have a high number of people living in poverty. We have a really high number of children and pensioners living in poverty. We've got a high level of in-work poverty. And some of these structural issues are extremely challenging to tackle and change when you have only one effective lever, as you say, one very effective lever. We will use it, but it's only limited in the impact that it can have on the whole system problem.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move on then to questions from my colleague Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thanks, convener, this morning. Good morning, Minister, and good morning, Mr. Kellett. Cross-portfolio working is something that I'm interested in because, as you've said, Minister, you know, the austerity that has been inflicted on Scotland by the UK government is costing £770 million a year at the moment. But, you know, and you said that we don't have all the levers in order to tackle what we need to do to help support tackling health inequalities. So I'm interested in, as a public health minister, what work has been done in other parts of the government, in other portfolios, to support tackling health inequalities.
So we recognise that it requires that cross-portfolio approach. And if we didn't know it before, which we did do, certainly the pandemic absolutely shone a light on those pre-existing health inequalities. And it not only shone a light on them, but it worsened them. And the government, Scottish Government, recognises that. We also recognise it's been such a terrible experience the last couple of years for almost everyone in Scotland. But actually, the learning that's come from the pandemic means that we found, for certain issues, we were able to turn and face these really difficult issues and have an impact which we had been unable to have before. So if you take the example of, for example, rough sleeping. Rough sleeping has been a priority to tackle for the Scottish Government ever since we came into power in the SNP, so 2007. It took till March 2020, in the face of a national emergency, for us to successfully be able to end rough sleeping because it was a necessity for the country. And what we found was, in the face of that national emergency, everybody collectively came together. And I always say in government, what we found was we did things that we thought were impossible. And I tell you what, we've got a taste for that now. So we're going to keep trying to do impossible things. We're going to keep trying to do these things that are really challenging. Deputy First Minister has a role right across government, so it's a really key part of our COVID recovery. He has a role right across government to try to bust these silos, which it seems to me it's almost a human norm that we create these silos in the way that we work. And his role across government is to bust those, to bring groups of ministers together on a regular basis to ensure that we're all aware of each other's work and it is all aligned and we are getting the maximum impact from across government in tackling these really thorny issues that Scotland faces.
And obviously the challenges are not just urban, they're rural as well. And, you know, you're a rural MSP like I am. So is there specific work that's been done looking at housing, for instance, looking at other wider areas that would support, help and support and will raise awareness of health inequalities in rural areas as well?
So certainly you're absolutely right to look at the differences. I mean, you and I, but actually every MSP around this table knows very well that you can't have a one-size-fits-all in Scotland. We might be a small country, but there's lots of different areas with very unique factors in each of them. One of the things that differentiates Scotland from the rest of the UK, so the Roundtree Foundation looked a number of years ago at the level of poverty in each of the UK countries, and one of the things that was protecting people in Scotland was the quality of our housing stock and the availability of social housing. Of course, the Scottish Government has had a huge programme of investment in social housing, and we've built more social housing. There is a challenge in terms of rural housing stock and the quality of it, and the difficulty of bringing it up to an appropriate grade for, in terms of insulation for fuel poverty. And that is vitally important, both in terms of tackling our net zero ambition, but also in tackling fuel poverty. We need to find ways to, you know, we've kind of done the low-hanging fruit. It's quite easy with modern housing, large-scale modern housing in an urban setting, to upgrade the insulation. It's much tougher in a rural setting with more dispersed housing, different types of housing, and different qualities of housing stock. It is a much tougher job, and we are really going to have to get into that. But that kind of illustrates that need to work together. So if we're going to achieve either or both of those ambitions with regard to tackling fuel poverty and aiming for net zero, we are going to have to get in about that challenging issue of improving housing stock in the rural areas. I mean, I don't need to tell you about the impact of the cost of fuel on a rural area. So whilst you have cheaper electricity in the south than we do in the far north, one of the things that's really challenging my community at the moment is the cost of fuel for cars, the lack of public transport option, the need to run a car, however well off you are, is a real challenge in rural communities at the moment. I had an absolutely heartbreaking communication from a constituent who's a pensioner who lived 20 miles from his local shop, had no fuel in his car, had £11 in his bank account, couldn't heat his house, because he couldn't afford to fill his oil tank, and that was his form of heating. So you'll all be aware that in many parts of rural Scotland you have to have this huge outlay in order to fill your oil tank in order to get any heat and hot water, and he couldn't afford that outlay. So he was in a cold house gathering wood for his wood fire. I mean, this is in 2022, gathering wood for his wood fire in order to heat his house, and unable to get access his nearest shop to buy food. It's just a disgrace, and it is absolutely about policy choices. So to relieve that situation, reducing the VAT on housing fuel, reducing, you know, or making it zero, reducing the VAT on fuel for his car. We can help with welfare policies, and of course my office directed him to all the funding that's available through the Scottish Government, but it's very difficult to tackle those particularly grisly issues, and it is only going to get worse. It is absolutely heartbreaking. And these people in my constituency, and I'm sure in your constituency, feel like these stories are hidden, because urban deprivation is so challenging for Scotland.
Just a final quick question. It's about anti-poverty measures that are being delivered and basically stopping folk working in silos. I know there's good work that's been done in Dumfries and Galloway Council of anti-poverty approaches using their budgeting and participative budgeting and things like that. Are we good at breaking down silos between local authority areas and the government? Are people embracing that? And you know, you said that the Deputy First Minister has oversight of this issue of trying to get people to get round the table. Are we embracing this non-silo working?
So I would have to say I've grown to believe it is kind of a human trait to silo off and to protect your own little area. I think we are recognising the benefits of working together to tackle, because we're in difficult times. There is absolutely no denying it. So I think people are recognising the benefit of working together in a way that we haven't ever before. The other thing, and I think it's key what you said, you talked about participative budgeting and getting the community involved. One of the really powerful means to keep us all working together in that way is to bring in the voices of lived experience, because it is easy sometimes to dismiss evidence when it's just on the page. It is very hard to have somebody look you in the eye, tell you their story, and then choose not to work together to make things better for that person. So I think having the voice of lived experience at the heart of our policy making and at the heart of our policy implementation is key to ensuring that we do continue to work together. I mean, perhaps it's just me, but I suspect it's not a desperately natural way for people to be. I think there are often, you know, there are sensitivities between local government and central government, central government in Scotland and central government in the UK, with our third sector partners. But we will get the most powerful impact if we are able to work together. Absolutely, that needs to be the goal.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Can I bring Carol Mockin in for a supplementary?
Hi, thanks, Minister. I'm just interested in that cross-government department working, and I'd be really interested to know if you have any examples where you feel that you've done it well. Transport, you know, that you mentioned being a really important one, as you say, particularly in rural areas. I would also be interested to know whether you could commit to asking the Deputy First Minister to give us some kind of plan, because I think it is key that the ministerial departments work closely together. And so perhaps if we had some kind of plan about how he would see the next year going ahead, it would be very helpful, particularly in this remit of health inequalities.
So certainly more than happy to ask the First Minister to bring forward some a plan of what's happening over the course of the next year, or an outline of the type of cross-portfolio working that he does. I mean, one of the areas I would say, which is outside of public health, where we see that real laser focus on tackling health inequalities, is in the child poverty plan. So that it's an absolute it's a national mission for this government, and you saw it prioritised even in the RSR, which was a really challenging set of figures for government to receive and work through and share with our partners and local authorities and in the public domain. But you see that tackling child poverty is still a priority within that. Our action against child poverty is firmly rooted in evidence, with a very robust evaluation strategy in there. And we are looking at cumulative impact assessment, wide-ranging analytical materials underpinning the approach outlined in our second Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan, and that's called Best Start, Bright Futures. Now, we see that plan has a really sharp focus on six priority family types who we know are at the greatest risk of poverty, including those from a minority ethnic background, those with a disabled household member, those with a lone parent family. And based on evidence, we're taking that balanced approach to tackling poverty, focusing on increasing household incomes through social security and employment, reducing household costs, and action focusing on those drivers of poverty, balanced with a focus on the next generation, supporting children to thrive, ensuring that we support the wider well-being of families. So we've talked already about the Scottish Child Payment, which we've already doubled in value, will further increase to £25, and we'll extend it to all children under 16. In my last portfolio, we had a massive social infrastructure investment in early learning and childcare, which we doubled the entitlement of it. And of course, that is where we get the biggest bang for our buck as a government. We all know and cannot deny the impact of poverty on a child can be lifelong. And tackling child poverty will absolutely deliver benefits in tackling health inequalities. It will be decades before we see those benefits, but it's absolutely the right thing to do. Did you want to come in, Michael?
Thanks. I was just going to add to that. I think the child poverty example is a really good example, and certainly as an official in government, I felt part of that broader team pulling together the child poverty strategy. Another area of policy that I think is a good example is around drugs and the National Drugs Mission. I support Angela Constance in that work too, and we are using that structure, the DFM group that the Minister talked about, to focus on the underlying causes of addiction. As the committee will know, there's a real focus in terms of the mission on MAT standards on treatment and on residential rehabilitation. But we also need to look at the underlying causes of addiction, and we're using that DFM group to think about how can us as drugs policy officials and Ms Constance work with ministers in education and local government and transport in economy around employment to tackle some of these underlying causes. So that gives us a structure and, if I'm being honest, from an official level, a pressure and a requirement and a real clarity from ministers that they need us to work better on a cross-portfolio basis in a way that I think is significant, it feels different and is making real changes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're going to move on to questions on national strategy. I'm going to be led by my colleague Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. At our meeting on the 24th of May, I asked Dr. Walsh that as we do not have overall powers for social security, taxation or employment in Scotland, would it make any difference if we had an overall strategy to reduce health inequalities? Dr. Walsh replied that though a strategy would be great, if the aim was to narrow health inequalities across society, the relevant powers would also be required. Could the Minister offer a view to us on these comments?
So it'll be no surprise to hear I don't disagree with David Walsh's assessment, and that's why at the beginning of this meeting I was very keen to put on the record very quickly that whilst I absolutely I welcome the scrutiny of what the Scottish Government is doing, I don't think any of us should kid ourselves where the power lies to tackle this and where the responsibility lies for the situation that we are in. So the, you know, this is a wealthy country, the UK, and it is a policy choice to perpetuate poverty. Those choices that coalition government made, the Lib Dem a Tory coalition in 2010, absolutely chose to pursue austerity policies. They reduced the funding to the Scottish Government, reduced the funding to local authorities, and brought in punishing welfare reform. And we are witnessing the tragic consequences of that now. And I mean, this is one of the reasons that I was politicised and came into politics in 2010. I worked as a mental health pharmacist in a psychiatric hospital, and I saw firsthand the impact of that welfare reform on the vulnerable citizens that I worked with. I worked mainly with people with schizophrenia and bipolar affective disorder, quite severe and enduring lifelong disabilities. And they were put through a system which was unable to recognise that their illnesses were disabling them and thrust them out into poverty and destitution without a second thought. And I saw that firsthand. So I will not deny the role that the UK government has in this. It is a profound impact. I mean, if we think about some of the particular policies, we have the two-child cap, which contravenes the UNCRC. A child who requires the support of the state is entitled to the support of the state, however many brothers and sisters they have. There's no conditionality in the requirement for the support. And just think about the impact of that policy. It's a choice to put children into destitution. It is absolute. We cannot shy away from this. If the Scottish Government had a policy which academics were clearly stating was life-shortening,
I'm sure I will be facing a great deal of scrutiny on that front. And I think that the UK government and the coalition government who made those decisions, for which we are now all paying the price, should absolutely face scrutiny on the consequences of those decisions. And I think I've forgotten your answer, I'm so mad. Your question, I'm so mad.
It was, would it make any difference if we had an overall national strategy?
So I don't think we can excuse ourselves. I can't be faced with this need and not take action. So I am absolutely clear that the powers lie in Westminster to tackle this fully, but that does not mean that the Scottish Government can't do anything, and we have to do everything that we can. We are faced with immense need on a daily basis, and we have to do what we can to rise and meet that need. There is no way of avoiding that, I would say. But I would say there are bigger issues. Scott, you know, there are bigger challenges placed at the door of the UK government. And of course, my solution would be for us not to be subject to the whims of the UK government. But that's a choice for the people of Scotland.
Okay. Emma, supplementary? Yeah. Sorry, Evelyn, for the question. Yeah, sorry, I'll take Evelyn and then I'll take my apologies.
Thanks, convener. Does the minister feel that health inequalities are a top priority for other organisations out with the health service that will all need to assist with health targets, such as local authorities, etc.?
So I think it is. I think it's easy to lose the focus on health inequalities, but I genuinely believe that my local authority colleagues are as troubled about this as I am. And there's amazing work going on in the third sector who do a power of creative work in difficult circumstances and insecure financial circumstances, frankly. So they do amazing things. I think it is easy to lose focus, and it is easy to take your eye off the evidence, and it is easy to feel overwhelmed by the situation that we face, because when you're faced with such desperate need, and we're hearing it day in, day out on the news from many people, the length and breadth of Scotland, just the and there's an understanding that it's only going to get worse. So I think it's easy to lose your focus on health inequalities. And I think part of my job is to make sure that we keep an eye on that golden thread of health inequalities, which runs through everything, and remember what causes health inequalities. Health inequalities are fundamentally caused by inequalities in wealth, inequalities in power, inequalities in status. And I need to, and all of our partners who are trying to tackle health inequalities need to remember that in everything that we do. We must not disempower our communities. We must not disempower individuals. Every policy that we bring together should be empowering them and should be helping to tackle inequalities. That's probably fundamentally why putting money in people's pockets is a far more powerful tool than giving them a box of food. It's a much more empowering experience.
Okay. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. Emma?
Thanks. Just a quick supplementary, Minister, just to back up what you said. We are constantly hearing about choices that are being made, or we're constantly talking about constraints, about mitigating austerity. We are constantly talking about these issues all the time. And so when choices need to be made, I mean, I'm thinking, when Scotland becomes an independent country, will this government continue to pursue the policies that will tackle the issues that are affecting people's lives, that are causing them to be facing poverty issues and leading to the health inequality? So that's the bottom line for me, is we can't constantly talk about mitigation, mitigation, mitigation. We need to be able to have the tools and the levers and the powers to do what we want. So that, for me, is the bottom line, is we will still need to make these choices when Scotland's an independent country, and these will continue to be the choices that we need to make.
You're absolutely right, and it isn't. These aren't easy choices for any government, and we see issues around health inequality affecting many countries around the world. But fundamentally, the UK is one of the most unequal countries in Europe, and when we compare it to our neighbours, it stands out. You know, it's not a great record to have the highest gender. Second highest gender pay gap, is it? It's not a great record to have such high levels of in-work poverty. So the policy choices that any government makes will make a fundamental difference to the level of inequality that's experienced. I'll pick up on your point around mitigations as well, because the situation that we're in at the moment, we are a devolved government, and our money that we have, as we are all aware, is largely dictated by the Barnett formula. So the choices that the UK government makes on spending account for the bulk of our budget. We get a population-based percentage of what they choose to spend in Scotland. And that restricts how much money we have. We have some levers over raising money in income tax, but we don't have all of the tax levers. We have no power over national insurance. Some economists would say it's pointless having any power over income tax if you don't also have power over national insurance. The two are almost always requiring to be balanced. The other thing that does is that money is for our devolved responsibilities. So about 70% of Scottish revenue spending is by the Scottish government on devolved issues. Every time we make a choice to mitigate a reserved issue, that means there is less money in the pot to spend on devolved issues. And that's why it cannot go on forever. That is not a limitless pot. We have devolved responsibilities that we have to spend money on, and we have limited means of raising extra money should we choose to do something different from the UK. So it is a difficult situation for any government to be in. Of course, another issue which came up time and time again during the pandemic is the inability to borrow. Most governments around the world are struggling at this moment in time to balance their budgets, but most governments have the opportunity to borrow. The Scottish Government has to bring its budget in bang on the money every time.
Okay, thank you.
Can I bring Sandesh Gohani in?
Thank you. Morning, Minister. What's the gender pay gap in Scotland in the Scottish NHS?
I can't give you that number at the moment.
It's 18.2%, and the Scottish NHS is fully devolved. So why have you not improved that?
So we are doing a lot. I mean, there is a lot of work goes on in order to improve the pay of the Scottish NHS. There is, as you know, people who work under Agenda for Change in Scotland are paid more than their counterparts in the rest of the UK. The gender pay gap in the NHS, I imagine, arises from the fact that there is a great deal of women working largely in the NHS. More than 50% of the employees in the NHS will be women. And yet, as we see in many other aspects of society, the people who are in the highest paid jobs, the managerial jobs, tend to be men. That is reflected right across society. But yeah, you're absolutely right to draw attention to that huge gender pay gap. Let me say my own profession of pharmacy has one of the biggest gender pay gaps that there are. And that starts not at the point where women go to have children. That gender pay gap starts at the point when we graduate from university. So from the point of leaving university, female pharmacists tend to earn less than male pharmacists. And we do need to put in place policies to tackle that.
Thank you very much. It's my intention now to move to our next theme, which is tackling the fundamentals of health inequality in Scotland, and Carol Mockin will lead.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, I want to start by saying that I absolutely condemn the policies from the current Conservative UK government. I thought it was interesting that Dr. Walsh did also talk about if we had a change in government at UK level, that would make an enormous difference to what we could do and what we could do in a devolved nation as well. But I think what's really important is in this committee, we talk about what we can do in Scotland. And I absolutely welcome her commitment to everything that we can. And I assure you, I will do my very best to hold you to that. I want to talk a little bit about the evidence that Claire Sweeney gave us. And I might just read a few points that she made, if you don't mind. So Claire Sweeney from Public Health Scotland said that although we have talked a lot about the challenges that we are facing in Scotland, the big message that I want to emphasise and get across is that we can do a lot about inequality. There are lots of levers and opportunities in Scotland to address this. It is by no means something that is intractable, and we can address it. She goes on to say, given the millions of pounds that the public sector spends in Scotland every year, there is a huge opportunity to use that money to good effect, and we see many things that we could do in Scotland. For example, we hold public bodies to account for financial and access targets, but we do not hold public leaders to account as strongly. This is something really clear and tangible that could be done. She also asks that she would like to see budgets spent across Scotland to be more closely aligned to impact things such as reducing inequality and child poverty. And her very last statement was, it is about the early years, access to education and training, having good and fair work, having a good and affordable standard of living, and having healthy communities in place so that people have access to green space, good transport. There is a lot of agreement on what can be done. We in Scotland need to mobilise the rest of the system to do this.
I mean, I wouldn't disagree with anything there, and I won't get into the details of your first comment around, you know, that government in the UK can change. Scotland has consistently voted left-wing, either Labour or SNP, for many, many decades, and we don't always get the government we vote for. We get the government that our neighbours choose, and that is fundamentally a challenge for the health of Scotland, frankly. Undoubtedly, if we look at the totality of the issues, I mean, I think there's much that Carol has said there that would chime with some of the policies that we're developing in the Scottish Government. So things like the anchor institutions, that is a recognition, and I'll let Michael come in and say a little bit more about that. That is a recognition that we have a powerful spending opportunity through spending on our NHS. That could be used to benefit communities. So we could use that spending power to ensure that, for example, individuals who are less likely to be in the workforce have opportunities to be employed, to be trained, and are supported to fulfil their potential. We could use that spending power on local procurement policies, which mean that, you know, all of the things that we have to buy to run the NHS could benefit local communities. We could use some of the assets that the NHS has for community empowerment projects, so handing over buildings and land to support communities to do what they want. And that's a really, I would say, hugely exciting opportunity. And if we get it right, it will absolutely have an impact. You mentioned the generality of the space that we live in. And I think there's, again, a lot of work going on right across the board in that. We talk about 20-minute neighbourhoods. There are different opinions, the length and breadth of Scotland, about how doable that is in different areas, but it's a great concept, isn't it, to have everything you need within walking distance of your house. And again, if you think about the twin challenges that we are facing in terms of tackling poverty, but also in terms of our ambition towards net zero, these are really important aspects for us to consider when we are thinking about what our environment looks like. I would like us, if I'm honest, to be thinking a little bit more about it in how we deliver our public services. As Public Health Minister, I'm a little bit tormented, if I am honest, that we keep centralising public services so that people have to travel a distance, often in my part of the world, in a car, in order to access things like healthcare services, in order to access local authority services. So we need to think a little bit more about how we can ensure that we deliver these services closer to home, which will be better for people's health. It'll make it easier. It won't put barriers in their way in terms of accessing those vitally important public services. And it will also make a difference to our net zero ambition. If we think about how many journeys are caused by travelling for NHS appointments. A final point, you mentioned early learning and childcare, and I would have to say that it was absolutely a huge privilege to be involved with delivering that policy last term of Parliament. I can't tell you how significant that social infrastructure investment is, and that will be benefiting children the length and breadth of Scotland and their families. So what we found was that that investment in high quality early learning and childcare has a direct impact on the individual child. It can literally close the attainment gap before it appears. So we know that the children from the poorest backgrounds are, at the point that they present at school, 5 years old, about 18 months behind their peers in terms of their language literacy and their numeracy. And early, high-quality early learning and childcare can reverse that gap. That's why we made the priority on eligible two-year-olds. About 25% of children in Scotland are eligible to access that early to try to close that attainment gap. But the benefit doesn't stop there. It doesn't just benefit the individual child. It benefits the families. I heard time and time again that these families who were really struggling, and many of us who are parents around this table will remember that sort of tag team parenting where one parent comes into the house and another parent leaves the house in order to work. A lot of families are living like that and living under immense pressure just to earn enough money to cover their household bills. What early learning and childcare does, high quality, provided free by the state, is gives them room to manoeuvre, room to have family time, which is also really important for them and for their children. The final thing, which is just mind-blowing, and I used to get very excited when I thought about it, is the impact of high-quality early learning and childcare, and we see this in studies from the US, is not just for that child as they reach their school years and through their education. It is actually lifelong. So children who have experienced high quality ELC, there is a measurable impact on their parenting ability when they have their own children. Now, as a government, how much do we love having policies that actually can effectively tackle some of those real intergenerational long-standing challenges that are being faced in Scotland. And that is absolutely something that we are committed to in the Scottish Government. That is why, despite all the economic benefits that come from ELC, in Scotland, our ELC was absolutely focused on the beneficial impact on the child, making sure it was high quality. Michael, if you want to come in.
Yeah. Thanks, Minister, and thanks for the opportunity. The Anchor's agenda is a really important one and a really exciting one, and it goes to the point that Claire made that you quoted around making full and best use of the collective power of particularly public sector institutions to improve the economy, the well-being, the health, tackle health inequalities of the communities that those institutions serve. And it's been a real priority for us. It's a priority, the top priority in the Place and Wellbeing programme the Minister referenced earlier. There's a real connection with the community wealth building agenda as well. And it really is about, it's quite simple, it's about using the power of the NHS, but also other local partners, as an employer, recognising the huge number of people that are employed by the NHS, as a contractor for services, and huge amounts spent by NHS and other public sector bodies on contracts, and also as an owner and user of buildings located in communities. We have prioritised that work. We've recently set up a kind of particular steering group to take that forward. Carol Potter, who's the Chief Exec of NHS Fife, has agreed to chair that group to really kind of drive it forward. But there may be two or three examples I could give the committee just now about the benefits of this approach. One is the new North East Glasgow Hub Health and Care Centre. It's a development in the northeast of Glasgow that will host three GP practices and a whole host of public and other third sector services. People can get the support they need, whether it's health-related, financial or just social connection. There'll be a community space there, including a cafe in the Parkhead Library. It'll also be a net zero facility. So an excellent illustration of how an NHS facility can become an anchor within its community. I know you've taken evidence from Clackmannanshire Council as part of this inquiry, and the work they're doing on their wellbeing economy pilot project has a real focus on anchors at its centre, and colleagues from Forth Valley NHS and from the council are part of our work. There's also work that NES are doing on the Youth Academy, partnering with schools in areas of deprivation right across Scotland to think about how they can encourage kids into working for the NHS in a range of roles that wouldn't otherwise have thought about these opportunities. And maybe closer to Mr Torrance's heart, and as you know, I used to be the Chief Officer of the Health and Social Care Partnership Fife. There's a really good example I'm aware of a project at the Victoria Infirmary of Kirkcaldy about encouraging people into the working in health and social care, supporting them through that, people who would have been nowhere near the labour market, and encouraging them into full-time employment for NHS Fife. So there's a whole range of these agendas happening across Scotland. What we want to do is identify best practices and make sure all of our institutions working with local partners are making the most of that to improve the well-being of their communities and tackle the health inequalities we're focused on today. Hopefully that's helpful. Thanks.
Thank you. Carol.
Thanks. Just very briefly, yes, I mean, very exciting and stuff to work towards. I think to get the full power behind it, I think what Claire Sweeney was saying is government need to be stronger in pushing the public leaders, and it, you know, just some kind of commitment from the minister around that. I think we would all agree that sometimes we do need to push people at the top to really see this as a priority, which can bring all these things to the fore.
Couldn't agree more. I'm more than happy to do that, and you're very welcome to hold my feet to the fire if you see that not happening.
Thank you. I have a particular supplementary from Tess White.
Thank you. I've got a question on the Women's Health Champion, Minister. But before I ask my question, I just want to refer to something. So as a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Personnel Development, I am delighted to hear you say that closing the gender pay gap is a really important area for you, a focus area for you, and that you will be taking action in Scotland, so thank you for that. In terms of my question about the Women's Health Champion, so the women's groups were delighted to hear last week the First Minister say that you will be appointing a health champion by the end of the summer. So my question, Minister, is what steps are you personally taking to ensure that the health champion, Women's Health Champion, will be in place by the end of the summer? Thank you.
So I'm confident that the Women's Health Champion will be in place by the end of the summer. The Women's Health Plan, which was, of course, the first such plan set out in the UK, I was really privileged and proud to do that last year. We had a number of short, medium and long-term outcomes that we hope to achieve. I would say, and there will be an update to Parliament in autumn, but we are very much on track to achieving and surpassing all of our short-term outcomes. We've made huge progress in improving the information available to women on a variety of different conditions like endometriosis, menopause, all of these things. On
you haven't answered my question.
No, I haven't finished yet, though, Tess.
Chair,
Chair, the convener, the minister, I just want to know what steps the minister is taking. I think we all know we've had a lot of work and know about the role of the Women's Health Champion, which we fully support. It's just my question was, what steps is the Minister taking to ensure that the Women's Health Champion is in place by the end of the summer? I'd just like an answer to that question, please. Thank you.
Minister.
So thank you. You're clearly not interested in the steps we're taking to implement the Women's Health Plan.
I'm very interested. I just want to know what steps, Convener. Thank you.
So we are working together with officials to make sure that the spec for that person's recruitment is absolutely where we want it to be. You'll know that the Women's Health Champion, the National Health Champion, will have to liaise with individual board champions who will also be put into place, who I think will make a significant difference in Women's Health Plan. We set that out as a medium term ambition. So at the moment, we are working on the job specification and looking to see how that is going to be funded and what it will be funded at, whether it is likely that it will be, what sort of people we think might apply for that role and what tightening up exactly what we think that role will require before we put it out to advertisement. And as I said, as the First Minister set out last week in Parliament, we expect that person to be recruited by the end of summer.
As a fellow of the Institute of Personnel Development, it can take longer. I'm just saying that the First Minister has committed by the end of the summer. If the job spec and person spec haven't been drafted yet, is the Minister saying that it is unlikely the role will be filled? Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ms White. And I think it's perhaps something we can take up as committee with the Minister after the session. I'm just conscious of time. I'm going to take a brief supplementary from Sandesh Gohani, and then I'm going to move on to our next theme.
Thank you. Minister, you spoke about the ELC, the 1140 hours. So may I ask, Minister, if your child turns three, between March and August, there is no funding until August. That's 6 months of no funding. And, you know, you spoke of the importance of being able to parent. You spoke of the importance of this allowing that to happen. So why is it, if you're born between March and August, your child turns three, there's no funding available?
So that's a standard way of delivering all sorts of education, is that they have certain dates in the year in which there is an intake. And that is the way that education works in Scotland. If your child turns four in a year, you're only going to be able to send them to school if they are four before a certain date. And if they aren't four before that certain date, they're going to have to wait the whole year before they can go to primary one. That's just, it's a function of delivering these policies, and it makes it manageable for local authorities. They know how many children they're going to have to come into the system over the course of the year. Of course, some local authorities make the decision to enable discretion on that point. So some local authorities will fund a child's place at early learning and childcare from the point of their third birthday. Other local authorities choose not to. I'm sure my Conservative colleague is supportive of ensuring that those local decisions are made according to local priorities and not taking that power away from local authorities. Let me also emphasise that those children who are particularly vulnerable in Scotland, those eligible two-year-olds, about 25% of the children in Scotland are funded from the age of two.
Thank you, Minister. Though, this is different to schooling when you turn up to school, because you can have your funding put over 52 weeks. So if your child is born in February, for those 6 months, you are funded for a place. And yet, if your child is born in March to August, you are not. So this is different to your answer. So why is that?
Off topic, yeah. So if the Minister could be brief in her answer, and I really would like to move on.
It's simply a function of the way that education is delivered in Scotland. Local authorities can use flexibility on that point. Many of them do, but not all of them choose to.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to come on to proportionate universalism and questions from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener. We got there. And thanks to the panel for attending today. In evidence, we've heard about the effects of proportionate universalism and about the inverse care law, the fact that, you know, those most in need of our services are often the most likely to actually miss out on them. So not turning up for tests, x-rays, hospital appointments, etc. So I'm wondering if the Minister is supportive of this concept of proportionate universalism, and also how Professor Marmot's work is influencing your approach to tackling health inequalities. Thank you.
So, yes, I am supportive of the concept of proportionate universalism. I agree with Sir Michael Marmot's position that action to reduce health inequalities has to be proportionate, with more intensive action lower down the social gradient. But action does also have to be universal to raise and flatten the whole gradient. So I absolutely agree. We do already deliver a number of services in that way. For example, we're currently refreshing our tobacco action plan. We're considering, among other initiatives, the role of minimum and maximum pricing on tobacco, as well as initiatives like the New Zealand phased approach to a smoking ban could be developed. Such action is universal in nature, and it would have an impact right across the population. So every member of every citizen in Scotland would benefit from those policies. But we do also target services in smoking cessation. We provide £9.1 million a year to health boards to fund smoking cessation services targeted at the most deprived areas, because that's where smoking rates are significantly higher. There's a big, as Carol Mochen regularly points out in the chamber, there's a huge difference in terms of numbers of people who smoke according to your socioeconomic background. It's something like 6 to 7% for people of the highest income and up near 30% for those of the lowest income.
Thanks very much, Minister. That's really helpful. As well, Dr. Peter Causton and his evidence as well, obviously stigma and trauma has a huge impact on these most deprived people. And he spoke about safety netting, which I thought was really interesting. But he also spoke, and this is where I'd like to focus, about the Chance to Change project group, who are now working alongside the Scottish Government as well, which is about helping people to help each other make a difference to their health and wellbeing. I was wondering if there were any kind of comments, if you could give us a little bit more information behind that. Thanks.
So, absolutely. I mean, there is a recognition from this government that adverse childhood experiences blight the lives of our citizens for their own. Can blight them for the entirety of their lives. It's not. There's no determinism about it. But there is a lot of evidence that the more adverse childhood experiences you have, the more likely you are to suffer ill health, for example, in adulthood, the more likely you are to smoke, the more likely you are to drink heavily. So there's lots of work going in around that. There's lots of work about developing trauma-informed services. One of the things which I think you're alluding to, and chip in if I'm on the wrong track, I think when I think about safety nets, I think, and it's not an obvious policy, but that policy of extending free bus travel to children up to the age of 21. So when we look at the Growing Up in Scotland data, we see that there is one of the things which is protective for children experiencing, having adverse childhood experiences is the ability to travel. And it seems like it's not directly related to tackling childhood experiences, adverse childhood experiences, but actually it's quite a powerful policy in terms of relieving them. And I was quite blown away when I first came across that link. But when I stopped and thought about it, I thought, well, of course, if you are able to travel, you are able to get out of very difficult life circumstances should you need to escape. You are also able to access public services in a way that people who don't have access to public transport can't. And it's clear that policies like that, which are universal, are also definitely having an impact on some of the most vulnerable people in our society. In terms of the Chance to Change, I mean, I'll ask Michael to maybe say a little bit more about that. But I suppose I was very struck you know, when you're talking about communities helping themselves and supporting communities to help themselves, just last week I met with a group of gypsy travellers who there was a remarkable piece of work going on facilitated by MECOP in, here in Edinburgh, training community health workers, and they were having a profound impact on their own community, a community which is much less likely to come forward and have, for example, cervical smears. Cervical smears are a really powerful preventative tool for maintaining good health. They catch cancer before it's even cancer. And that work was just an insight into the impact that people can have in their own community. Communities which are marginalised find it very hard to trust people outside the community. Of course they do. They've had a lifetime and sometimes millennia of abuse and discrimination. So actually finding and identifying those people in the community who can help their own community to access healthcare is really, really important. And there's powerful, powerful work and powerful testimonies and case studies coming forward in that meeting last week. Michael.
Thank you. Thanks. Very happy to provide further information to the committee. We'd like it on the Chance to Change group. However, the key thing, I think, from my perspective, is that focus on supporting communities, particularly those communities suffering from the most deprivation, to support themselves to tackle health inequalities is a fundamental part of Place and Wellbeing programme alongside the work on anchors that I talked about earlier. So we're seeking to learn from best practice. So there are a range of initiatives. I work closely with Inspiring Scotland. They do work in a number of communities across Scotland, grassroots organisations, building local social capacity to support communities to support themselves. Part of the challenge, though, is that work tends to be episodic. Quite often the funding isn't maintained in terms of long-term impacts on tackling the health inequalities. We've talked about that is a challenge. So one of the things we're doing as part of that programme is thinking about how do we better share best practice? How do we ensure funding and support is sustainable and mainstreamed in the way that will work in the longer term? So that focus on community-based support is something that's really important to us, and we're taking forward under the Place and Wellbeing programme. And I can provide more details about that too, if that would be helpful. Thanks.
Thanks very much. Convener, can I just say it would be really great to have some more information, maybe some written information in the Gypsy Traveller work. That would be fantastic. No, thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to take Emma Harper has a supplementary, so we're going to take Emma and then ask Emma to move on to our next theme after that, which is on health and all policies.
Okay, thanks. It's just to pick up on what you said about gypsy travellers and cervical cancer, because I know that there are a reduced uptake or participation in cervical cancer screening in areas of higher deprivation, but also in Black, Asian and minority ethnic women as well. And I know there's a self-sampling of HPV cervical cancer research that's been done right now, and NHS Dumfries and Galloway is part of that. So is that something that will help then tackle the reduction of uptake in cervical cancer screening if we can move forward the self-sampling process?
So, absolutely. I think self-sampling will help. There are a number of reasons why people don't engage in the cervical screening programme. Sometimes there are disability issues, which make it very difficult for women to access somewhere that they can actually get a smear. There are sometimes issues, cultural issues, which make it less likely that women will come forward for a smear and more likely that they would do it at home. A big factor that we often don't talk about is the women who have experienced sexual violence and how hard it is for them to undergo such an invasive test. And of course, we know that many women in society have experienced sexual violence. So there are a number of reasons why women don't come forward for cervical smears. And I absolutely believe that self-testing at home will improve the situation. It's not the entirety of the solution. So if you look at, for example, our bowel screening programme, that's all done at home. It's not invasive. It's easy for people to do. And we don't have 100% uptake on that. So we still need... We have more work to do to make it easy for people and to help them to understand why it's so important. Tragically, I mean, we have an opportunity to eradicate cervical cancer now because of the advances in smear in sampling and in the advances in vaccination, and the World Health Organization is very keen in developing a programme of work on that, and I in Scotland am very keen that Scotland should participate in that. I would love to see cervical cancer eradicated, but tragically one of the associations that we see is the very people who are less likely to participate in the vaccine programme are also the people who are less likely to come forward for a smear. So that makes it very difficult. And I'm seeing that in my work on bloodborne viruses. We have to work extra hard to understand why some people do not participate. And we have to go to extra lengths to reach them. But these things, I mean, eradicating bloodborne viruses, eradicating the Hep C and eradicating the transmission of HIV is also thanks to advances in technology within our grasp. We just have to work really hard to find the people and make sure we get them into treatment.
Thank you. Thanks Okay, I'll just move on to the health in all policies. A couple of quick questions. I think in a previous session I asked about health inequality impact assessments being included in planning, for instance. So, so again, it's across other portfolios looking at the inclusion of health inequality impact assessments. So can the Minister describe for us what is the Scottish Government doing, or what is the Scottish Government's work to include health inequality impact assessments in all policy areas?
So the Scottish Government does continue to advocate the use of HIIAs in a health in all policies approach to policy teams across government, across public bodies and wider stakeholders, supporting colleagues to embed them in practice and ensure that the potential impact of policies and programmes on health inequalities and the wider determinants of health is fully considered. Now, the HIIA guidance was last updated in 2016 and Public Health Scotland will be updating it later this year. We're also working very closely with Glasgow City Region, Glasgow GCPH and PHS in the development of a new tool to measure the impact that major housing and transport projects can have on improving health and wellbeing and reducing health inequalities across the Glasgow City Region. Ultimately, we would like to see the use of HIIAs in health and a health in all policies approach. There is a great deal of learning to be taken from countries like Wales. They made them a statutory requirement for public bodies when the Public Health Bill Wales was 2016 was passed in the Welsh Senedd. And I'm interested in taking that approach in Scotland too.
All right, thanks. That's my quick question. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We come now to questions on public services, and Gillian Mackay will lead on that.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to both of the panel. Last week, a committee asked Dr. Peter Costin, a DPN GP, about whether services are trauma-informed and highlighted that tackling stigma involves everyone who works in a health and social care setting having a better understanding of how trauma impacts throughout a person's life and how trauma affects behaviour. He said that trauma-informed training is more available, but there's still much work to do. What's the government doing to promote the importance of services being trauma-informed and ensure that all health and care staff undergo trauma-informed training?
So it's a really, really important point. And I talked about how the government well recognises and understands the impact of adverse childhood experiences on somebody's entire life course. It is really important that our public services are trauma-informed. It is disappointing that there are times when we feel that people presenting looking for support from public services are further traumatised by what they meet in our public services, and we really have to work hard to get that right. The Deputy First Minister told the Finance and Public Administration Committee in November 2021, we need our public services to wrap around people and to be person-centred and holistic and responsive to their needs, instead of expecting people to fit around what public services offer and expecting them to navigate complicated systems from positions of vulnerability and from need. Now, we are backing this up with action. One of those actions is increasing the availability of training in trauma-informed practice. We are also trying to simplify, it's an almost impossible task, but trying to simplify the way that some of our services are delivered in order that that is much simpler. We are thinking more and more now, and again, Michael might wish to say more. You'll all know that for our children and young people, we talk about GERFIC regularly, getting it right for every child. We're now thinking for our adult population, we need to think GERF, and I would say E, GERF-E. We haven't quite decided on that acronym, or at least I haven't settled on it yet. I'm campaigning for it to be GERF-E. But that's about getting it right for everyone, every time, so that our services, instead of, you know, when you think of people who are, you know, presenting, if we think about, for example, the work that Angela Constance is doing in drug addiction, a very important example, one of the challenges in that area is that it is quite hard for people to get into treatment and very easy for them to fall out of it. And we need to make it easier for people to present. We need to make it easier for people to get treatment quickly when they present. And we need to make it hard for them to come out of treatment. We need to be trauma-informed, understand where that individual is in their journey to recovery, and catch them and hold on to them until we can get them better. There needs to be a reduction in stigma in these services. There needs to be dignity in everything that we do. But that's a classic example of how we can transform these services. It takes a lot of work, but we are absolutely on it. And working, and that's just one little microcosm. When I think about, you know, I have responsibility for a lot of chronic illnesses, and the last thing I want is for people, for individuals, to feel like they are a collection of conditions. I'm really keen to ensure that people are able to access holistic, person-centred care, that they don't have to present several weeks running at different clinics for different bloodletting, for different things, and that actually they can present in one place and have holistic, person-centred care. And that will make their lives easier, it will make them more productive economically, and it will save money to the NHS. Why wouldn't you do it? It's a bit trickier to achieve in reality than it is in our imagination, but we are definitely recognising the benefits for us, but also absolutely for individuals who are trying to access public services.
Thanks, Minister. A couple of things to say, if that's all right. On GERF-E, GERFET is another example which I think is getting it right for everyone together. The Minister and others will decide what the best one is. But that focus on how we wrap our services around an individual to understand them, to best meet their needs, building on the GP contract. And it's the central focus of the preventative and proactive care reform programme that the Minister talked about earlier. That's about building that multidisciplinary team, sometimes called the principal care team, ensuring that care, and that's right, that's beyond health, it's into housing and other support as well. So I think that is really important. The second thing is just to cycle back to your question about trauma-informed training. So, and the committee is probably aware of this, it's probably useful to say, though, that since 2018, the government has invested over £5 million in national trauma in a national trauma training programme. A total of £3.2 million of that has been funding distributed to local authorities to work with community planning partners to further that agenda. And our commitment is that by April next year, we will publish a long-term delivery plan for the next phase of the national trauma training programme. The other thing I'd like to say, and it cycles back to the question Ms. Harper asked earlier, I saw recently, the Minister, you may not be aware of this, but a really fantastic programme that the Meadows Clinic are developing. The Meadows Clinic is a facility in NHS Forth Valley that supports women who are the victims of sexual violence around all their healthcare needs, including the acute point after the attack. But one of the initiatives that the Meadows Clinic told us about was how they support victims of sexual violence through to access cervical screens, cervical smears, and they do that on a trauma-informed basis. And they've had early success because of their way of working, building trust, working with those women, and persuading and encouraging women who were refusing to access cervical screens for some of the reasons that will be obvious to the committee to go through that process. And one of the discussions we had is about if that's successful in its early days, how do we think about rolling that out nationally so the victims of sexual violence right across Scotland can be supported in that trauma-informed way. So I thought it was a really inspiring project and thought it was useful to share with the committee. Thanks.
No, absolutely. And thank you. Thank you both for those answers. Dr. Shari McDade highlighted that if there's just one-off training sessions in the trauma-informed approach, people will be expected to go back to their systems of working and try to remember what they learned during that one-off programme. They emphasised the need to ensure there is ongoing reflection and said that embedding reflective practice is the next step that needs to accompany the training programmes and education in the trauma-informed approach. What action is the government taking to ensure reflective practice accompanies trauma-informed training?
So I think that many health and social care professionals already embed reflective practice into their, certainly the regulated professions already embed reflective practice into their development. I'll take on board the point you've made about maybe making sure that that becomes part of the trauma-informed package, because I know that that goes out to a much wider staff pool or than simply the regulated health professionals, and it's well worth me going back and checking that is there. I think as well as the reflective practice, so I mean it is not just about an individual's practice, it is about changing the system so that it is more person-centred, more flexible, more holistic in the way that it's built and designed and delivered and implemented, rather than just the individual practice. If we focus on the individual's practice, firstly, I don't think we'll achieve our goal, and secondly, we run the risk of an extremely weary workforce feeling like the reason that things aren't working is their fault, and it absolutely isn't. We have built these systems, and we didn't deliberately build them this way. They evolved over time to meet needs. But, you know, most people would acknowledge that some of our most vulnerable citizens are having to navigate a really complex, bureaucratic system on a day-to-day basis simply to get the help that they have a right to. And that's not good enough. And we need to really reflect on that and build it better.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much. Okay, we're now going to move on to questions about the role of community link workers. I'm going to ask Tess White to lead this area.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Minister. In 2016, the Scottish Government set a target to recruit 250 community link workers by the end of the parliamentary term. In your area in the Highlands and in my area in Aberdeenshire, we still haven't got any community link workers, accepting that you weren't the minister then, but now you are. So can you share with us, please, what work you are leading on to make sure that the target is delivered? Thank you.
So, of course, we have delivered the target for Scotland. There are now more than 300 community link workers employed across Scotland through the Primary Care Improvement Fund. From this year, we're going to be building on their successes with the introduction of the new multidisciplinary mental health and wellbeing teams in primary care, which will include new community link workers and an emphasis on social support and social prescribing where that's appropriate for the person. In 2021, we commissioned Voluntary Health Scotland to establish the Scottish Community Link Worker Network to strengthen that role and to increase the wider understanding of the contribution that link workers make to tackling health inequalities. And we're also embedding welfare rights and money advice services across 150 primary care settings over 2 years in deprived communities across Scotland.
If I can follow up, so Minister, you haven't answered the question. The question was, just in Aberdeenshire, not a single link worker has been, unless I've got my figures wrong, has not been appointed, and in your area in the Highlands, still not a single link worker. So can you assure us that action, you are leading on action to make sure those posts are filled? Thank you.
Yes, I can. And I will take action and come back to you.
Okay, thank you. I've got a supplementary from Gillian Mackay. If Gillian still wants to come in, then I'll bring David Torrance in. So, Gillian.
Yep. A lack of joined up care has been highlighted to the committee, with some patients falling off the cliff edge once they're discharged from services. As an example, patients are not always connected with community care once discharged from hospital. So how can we ensure that there are better links between acute and community care? And what role can link workers play in this regard?
So I think link workers can be a really important tool in terms of that holistic care that I talked about, that understanding of the social determinants of ill health and the work that they do to maximise income and ensure that people don't fall through the net, frankly. So I think they're a really powerful tool. I think also, though, we have to reflect on the systems that are leading to that sensation of people falling out of the net as they go from secondary care into primary care. And I think everybody would acknowledge that there is a risk at every interface within the health service, of which there are many, that communication can fail and that folk can be lost to follow up. That interface between, and we're looking very carefully at it just now as we build the social care system and look at how we improve communication between health and social care. There is a recognition that communication, even within health, is challenging at times. We think there could be digital solutions that make it simpler to transfer information from one area of the health service to another, and potentially to areas outside the health service or to social care, and with the individual's permission, perhaps to third sector organisations. But we're definitely a little distance away from these digital solutions. Another thing that might come with some of these digital solutions is that people would be in charge of their own information, and it would be an empowering experience. My colleague Kevin Stewart, if he were here, would talk eloquently, I have no doubt, about the many, many people he meets who are re-traumatised by having to tell their story time and time and time again. And they can't understand why their story, having told it once to somebody in the system, does not then follow them through that system. So we're very aware of these issues. We're working hard to improve and to resolve them. I mean, one of the ways that we will build these systems better in future is by having lived experience at the heart of it. I think if we have lived experience at the heart of policy development, we're much more likely to get policy right. And I think it also holds us to account with policy implementation, because we are much more likely then to find out the gulf that there sometimes is, but often a gap, between what we intend and what actually happens on the ground. And I think that's the best way of making sure that we achieve our policy aims, is by having lived experience hold us to account. I don't know if you have any more to say on that, Michael.
I think you've covered it, Minister. No, thank you.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. David Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and Mr. Kellett. Minister, can you expand on the success that community link workers have had in the most deprived areas? And how do we make sure that these workers have the resources to engage with the other key sectors here, like the third sector, which is really important? And how do we get that information back from the third sector to show that we're having that success?
Yeah, I mean, data collection is a challenge right across the board, isn't it? But it is important that we show how effective these policies are, absolutely. Community link workers are at the forefront of our efforts to tackle the consequences and the determinants of health inequalities, and they work directly with individuals to help them to navigate and engage with wider services. And we know they're invaluable in supporting people with issues like debt, issues like benefits advice, social isolation and housing. And they also are really important at connecting individuals to community resources, so helping to make sure that individual folk find out about food banks and are able to take that first step to get that kind of support, helping them into mental health provision, and they provide people with ongoing emotional support. Now, that is all quite hard to capture. We can, you know, we can say we've employed X number of community health workers, but, you know, as Tess White pointed out, that doesn't necessarily mean that we've got national coverage. We have achieved the national aim. It doesn't necessarily mean we have national coverage. So we need to keep going back and looking at the data and looking at the outcomes and looking at the difference, perhaps with qualitative data rather than quantitative data, just at the impact, and see if we can capture the impact that community link workers are making.
I might come in. Thanks, Minister. Just to build on that, I think there's real power in this community of community link workers. And the Minister spoke recently at an event, a reception here in the Parliament for the, I might get the name wrong, but I think it was a Social Prescribing Scotland network. Members of the committee may have been there as well. And I think that point about capturing qualitative evidence is really important. So real passion from that group, self-organised, association of effectively community link workers, and they told a couple of stories that evening, one about a young man living in Wester Hale, supported by a community link worker, a veteran who had disengaged from society, living in a house without electricity, heating his kind of water on a kind of billy can type scenario, and in really difficult position around his mental health. And the community link worker told the story of her engagement with him, how that built over time, built trust, connected him with housing services, got his electricity reconnected. And there are stories like that that those colleagues tell time and time again. So I think the power of that, those community link workers, that social prescribing approach is really profound. One of the things we are doing in government, again, as part of the care and wellbeing portfolio, is seeing how we can further support social prescribing and community link workers to really improve the health and wellbeing and tackle some pretty profound health inequalities as well. Thanks.
I must admit they were a very, very impressive bunch, and I absolutely got the impression of a passionate army of social justice warriors out there doing their best for Scotland. It was really, really powerful, the presentations that they made, and I had met with them shortly before. The work that they're doing is really, really impressive in that, you know, absolutely getting alongside people and helping them to flourish.
Thank you. We now come to questions on systemic inequality, and Sandesh Gohani will lead this section.
Thank you. Just before I get into my questions on systemic inequality, I wonder if the Minister would join me in asking anyone who's available for any screening programme to attend it.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. We have really effective screening programmes that are well evidenced, that are largely easy to access, and it is really important that people do attend and participate in screening. For most of them, it's about early detection of problems, which, as everyone knows, means that they are much more treatable if they're caught at an early stage. For cervical cancer, it is unique in that it catches it before it's even cancer. It's not about catching cancer early. It's about preventing cervical cancer. And for me, that's a really powerful reason to participate in that screening programme.
Thank you, Minister. And so onto the topic. Do you feel there is systemic racism within the Scottish NHS?
I think there is systemic racism in every aspect of society. I think it would be foolish to deny it, frankly. I think that we have seen over the last couple of years a riot, you know, with the Black Lives Matter movement, has shone a light on systemic inequalities. The experience of the pandemic, where we saw that Black and minority ethnic communities were more likely to work in jobs that meant that they were exposed to the virus. They were more likely to live in housing that meant that that virus spread right through their families, and they were more likely to live in poverty. These are all systemic issues that we cannot close our eyes to, and we have to acknowledge. That doesn't mean that they're easy to tackle, and I think every society has to be focused on ways of tackling these systemic inequalities that have built up over centuries, sometimes millennia in the case of women. There's not a society in the world, I don't think, that doesn't have a challenge with inequality for women. So acknowledging how difficult it is to tackle these things, and acknowledging that they are there, and absolutely eyes open and mind open to ways to improve the situation.
So, with systemic racism within the Scottish Health Service, which you have said does exist, so not only is that a problem for the staff, but it's also a problem for the patients. And one of the big issues that patients have, and we'll set aside the staff issue for now, but one of the big problems that patients have is that accessing of healthcare, because they don't feel that it is for them. How can we address that and improve?
So you're absolutely right. When people are experiencing systemic racism, it is very hard for them to access public services because it feels like society is not built for them. And an acknowledgement of that and an endeavour to improve the situation, I think, is really important. If I go back to talking about the work that we're doing and the Gypsy Traveller community that I met with recently, that's one example of how community health workers from within that community were able to make a significant difference to the health of their community. And I think that's an issue worth exploring. Another issue I would say is about it is important that we have good data to guide us. And it is always difficult to find data for people who are outside of the system. So we can, and we have been better and better, and certainly the vaccine programme was one of the first areas where we collected ethnicity data at the time of administration. That's been really helpful in focusing our efforts on outreach programmes to ensure that those minority ethnic communities who were less likely to take up our offer of the vaccine, we put in special programmes to go and reach them. So with the Polish community, with the Black community, with the Pakistani community, there were extra efforts made and successfully so. I think it's much more difficult to capture those people who aren't participating at all. So the Gypsy Traveller community talked to me about just how difficult it is for them to register with a GP because they move around all the time. They're not in one location. And that, by definition, made it almost impossible for them to even get into the healthcare system. And it's very difficult to capture data on the people who are completely excluded from the healthcare system. A final point I would make is an issue around research and studying. So much like women, so women have suffered from this being a man's world, and much of the medical research that has gone on over the last century in terms of development in medical understanding has been focused on men. Men are much more likely to participate in clinical trials than women are, for understandable reasons around pregnancy and childbearing. But that means that our understanding of men, and these are largely white men in the developed world, is far greater than our understanding of women and our understanding of men from ethnic minorities, and particularly of women from ethnic minorities. That are real gaps in our understanding. And we can see that played out in real life. So there are a couple of studies going on in England. I think one or two of them have reported recently around the impact of ethnicity on outcomes in maternity, so in birth. And whilst those are English studies, academic studies, I am absolutely sure that there will be lessons for us to learn in Scotland from that understanding, because there is really solid evidence of health inequalities and of those black and minority ethnic women suffering quite severe health inequalities as they pass through the maternity services. We need to look at that, understand it, learn from it, and implement changes in Scotland too.
Thank you. And you're right, Minister, when you say that, because black and ethnic minority women are more likely to die when they're pregnant. And I've got two examples with my final question. And the first one, it seems very simple and small, but if we talk about sticky plasters and Band-Aids, I would have a cut and I'd have a sticky plaster and a Band-Aid on. I didn't realise they were supposed to be skin-coloured. And when they were produced in different colours, it made a world of a difference, because you put a sticky plaster on, it's not big and obvious and showing that something's happened. And it's things like that that really matter. It really does. And it is only when I saw it did I notice how awful it was. And my other example, and this is where my question is going to come in, if we look at the Indian community with Sikhs and Hindus, there are no information leaflets available in Greater Glasgow and Clyde in Hindi. Public Health Scotland produced a report and it talked about the Muslim community, it talks about Polish, it talked about black community, but nothing in there about Indian communities, about Hindus and Sikhs. And my question is, why not? And why is this rather large community excluded?
So I would need to be asking Greater Glasgow and Clyde precisely that question, and I will go and do that. I think there are, you're absolutely right about these tiny things making a big difference. I think that as a woman, I absolutely recognise that I live in a man's world, and I have daily reminders of that. And I think it's exactly the same for people of black and who are a black and ethnic minority. Those small reminders that this world is not your world will have a profound effect on them, far greater than whether they got a plaster on their cut or not, frankly. And I think you're right to point to these small things making a big difference. I think it is important that we take care of these small things, and it's frankly incredible that we haven't thus far. In terms of ensuring that health information is available in many different languages, I'm sure that Greater Glasgow and Clyde do make sure that health information is available in multiple languages, and I know that they have access to translators. There is the greatest ethnic diversity in that particular health board area in the whole of Scotland. And I know that, you know, making sure that things are available in different languages might not go far enough. They may have other alternatives where things can be easily translated, you know, if it's available on a website or something like that. The final point I would make is that we need to go a little further than just ensuring that we have information available in different languages. We need to make sure that our work is culturally sensitive to whoever we are caring for. And I think that that is, I hear that time and time again from people from minority communities. I think quite recently, I'm sure that almost all of you here on the committee will have heard about how LGBTQ plus community feels, and there is evidence that alcohol services are not meeting their needs. So we need to, you know, it's not, what I'm saying is we need to go further than a tick box exercise of ensuring that information is available in different languages. We absolutely need to do that, but we need to go further as well, and we need to have person-centred services that absolutely get alongside people and are sensitive to the culture that they are from, and ensure that we can deliver care that is sensitive to their cultural needs, and they don't feel like they are outside of that community.
Thank you. We're going to move now to our final theme this morning, which is the pandemic and indeed the cost of living crisis. So I'm going to begin just by asking, you know, what is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that those who are already vulnerable and have been affected by health inequalities are not further disadvantaged in terms of COVID recovery and the cost of living crisis?
So the cost of living crisis is impacting absolutely every household in the UK, and the Scottish Government will continue to do everything in its powers and within its fixed budgets to ensure that people, communities, businesses are supported as far as possible. Through the budget for 22-23, the Scottish Government's allocated almost £3 billion to a range of supports that will contribute to mitigating the impact of increased cost of living on households. And for people living in Scotland, this means a £150 payment for those in receipt of council tax reduction, and for those in council tax bands A to D, supporting 1.85 million households. A further £10 million for the Fuel Insecurity Fund, helping households at risk of severely rationing their energy use or self-disconnecting entirely. Investments in a range of measures unique to Scotland, like £520 paid for around 144,000 school-aged children from low-income families through bridging payments in 21-22, nearly 82,000 unpaid carers receiving £491.40 of additional support this year through the carers allowance supplement. 8 Scottish benefits, including the Best Start grant payments, uprated by 6% to ensure that these essential payments keep pace with rising cost. 92,000 households protected from the UK government's bedroom tax, which, as I'm sure you're all aware, was a policy that was particularly had an impact on people with disabilities. Action to protect a further 4,000 households, which 97% of those 4,000 households have dependent children, protecting them from the UK government benefit cap, which reduces benefit awards by an average of £2,500 a year.
Thank the Minister for that summary of actions. I wonder if I can just ask on the point about the cost of living payment. The payment obviously is the same strategy that's employed by the UK government in terms of council tax. There are people sitting around this table who will have received that £150. Does the Minister feel that there would be better ways to deliver that in terms of looking at a more focused approach to supporting people, particularly those who are in the most need? Because this inquiry is interested in the inequalities and trying to protect from the exacerbation of inequalities. So I wonder if I could have the Minister's thoughts on that.
I think Kate Forbes was very clear when she announced that payment that she was balancing the tension between getting it to the right people and absolutely focused on the people who needed it most, and the speed required to get it out the door and into people's hands. And I think there is a frustration in the Scottish Government that we find, and we found that through the pandemic, and I'm absolutely sure there will be reflection on it, that there aren't always easy mechanisms in place to get money into people's hands. That will improve with the growth of the social security system, but it isn't always easy for us to identify the individuals who need the most help and to get the money directly to them. And that particular payment was, I believe, and I think that Kate Forbes was very frank about it at the time that it was announced, that it was a compromise between getting it out fast to the people who needed it most, knowing that some people who got it wouldn't be in need of it.
Okay, and I wonder if I can ask a question related to some of my previous questions in terms of support for local government. I think local government, again, will be at the forefront of the impending storm, or the storm that we are currently in around cost of living, and that's evident, I think, in terms of services like welfare rights and money advice. And again, I think in terms of all public health approaches, local government need to do more. I think they've been asked to do more with less. And the Accounts Commission, for example, has pointed to a 4.2% real terms cut in terms of local government budgets. Do you feel, Minister, it's sustainable for that level of cut to local government to be able to deliver what we want to try and achieve?
So there's, it is absolutely challenging times ahead at the moment. So if I think about the cost of fuel, energy prices rises, and the impact that that has on public services. The cost of heating a nursing home is higher. The cost of heating a hospital is higher. The cost of heating a sports hall is higher. The cost of running a swimming pool is higher. And all of those things were uncalculated for, largely, when budgets were being set just a few months ago. So that inflationary increase in energy costs alone is having an immense impact on people's ability to deliver public services. If you think about the cost of inflation and capital costs, I mean, I was chatting to a sports organisation recently who had managed to get a great deal of money from in order to renew their ground, and they were recognising that within a year, £1 million becomes 0.9 of £1 million. That's how high inflation is at the moment, and that's how fast the pot of money is going down. So it is really challenging times for absolutely everyone, and it is particularly challenging for those who are required to deliver public services. It's a challenge for Scottish Government, and it's a challenge for local authorities. It's a challenge for our NHS boards too. I think what that requires, though, in order to rise and meet that challenge, is that we innovate and that we think creatively and that we really carefully prioritise what it is we need to do, and we work collaboratively in a way that we are, if I go back to very early in this evidence session, in a way that may not be particularly natural for us. Because in order to achieve some of the things that we want to achieve and that we have to achieve in Scotland, we are absolutely going to have to work together and pool our efforts in order to achieve those outcomes. There's just no way around it. Financially, things are really difficult at the moment, and it is going to be necessary to collaborate to an extent we never have before.
Would you accept, though, that because of year-on-year of cuts to services, and I say this as someone who served 10 years in a local authority as a councillor, that many of the services we really need don't exist anymore? And that innovation and collaboration can't often take place because we don't have the people or the skill sets in local authorities to be able to do that.
So, I mean, I guess you and I are absolutely agreed that the austerity politics that came in 2010 have been severely detrimental to our local authority colleagues and to Scotland as a whole. There have been policy decisions made to cut government budget, to cut the Scottish government budget. Some of those cuts have had to be passed on, but actually when I look at the numbers, I see that local authority has been largely protected from a lot of the cuts compared to local authority in services in England, some of whom have found themselves in a really precarious situation. And I think all of us, well, not all of us, but you and I certainly would agree that austerity politics has been really harmful. And I go back to David Welsh's testament, which is that we are paying tragic consequences for decisions that were made some time ago. We went into the pandemic in 2020 on the back of 10 years of austerity politics. And I think there is absolutely no doubt that we would have fared better in the pandemic had we not been in that situation when the pandemic hit.
I mean, the Minister and I'm very conscious of time, could have a back and forth on this, because I think the feeling on the ground in local government might be that Scottish Government decision-making has had a huge impact also in terms of the choices and decisions were made, particularly around often the underfunding of Scottish Government-led initiatives, some of which we've had a discussion about this morning. But I'm very conscious of the time this morning allowed to the committee, and as I say, we could have a further discussion on that, but I think the point has now been made from both our points of view and is now on the record. But I know that Gillian Mackay had a supplementary on this, so I'm willing to give the last word to Gillian.
Thanks, Convener. In their submission to the committee, the Health and Social Care Alliance highlighted that people with long-term conditions have been particularly impacted by a deterioration in their health and wellbeing due to the cost of living crisis and having to use different healthcare aids and support and things along those lines. What action is the government taking to help support these people, give them access to support from other places, and to address this as a whole?
So there is definitely, there is absolutely a recognition that people with disabilities or with long-term conditions will be more impacted by the cost of living crisis. If you just think about it on a very human basis, they quite often, as you say, have equipment that requires to run on electricity. The cost of charging that equipment will and running it is significantly more today than it was this time last year. And then we think about if people are at home all day, and almost all of us have an insight into that, there is, after the pandemic, there is the cost of heating your own home to a standard that makes it livable. And I can move around more and put more layers on. That is not an option for people with profound disabilities, and it's not an option I would want them to face. So there is work, as you would expect, going on within government to assess the situation and to see what we can do to meet those needs. I don't know if Michael wants to say anything particularly more, or if it's something that we would we can write back to you in terms of what support might be offered to those particularly vulnerable groups as we face this cost of living crisis, which, you know, is something that we haven't, and it comes on the back of another crisis, so in the back of an epidemic, on the back of Brexit, on the back of an epidemic, and then right into a cost of living crisis where food is costing more and energy prices are costing more. It is a really, really difficult time for society, and Scottish Government is trying hard to make sure that our attention is well and truly focused on the people who need our care most.
Thanks, Minister. Not much to add. The Alliance are key partners. They are very good advocates for the people they represent, and we work with them very closely. I think the points you've made around the inequity, even in terms of impact on people with disabilities, is a very good one. I know we're working really hard in the short term to look at what further support we can put in place. I suppose the only other thing I would say, that in the longer term, the National Care Service is hugely important and being welcomed by the Alliance and other groups in terms of ensuring consistent social care of high quality right across the country. But I recognise the point you made about short-term support, and if there's more we can provide to the committee, be very happy to do that. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. That concludes our questions. Can I thank the Minister for her contribution in this regard? I am conscious that we have another item of business with the Minister. Would the Minister want a comfort break at this stage?
I'm fine, actually.
Okay, grand. So our third item today is consideration of an affirmative instrument, which is the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Act 2016 Supplementary Provision Regulations 2022. The purpose of this instrument is to ensure that environmental health officers are able to issue fixed penalty notices in respect of the offence of smoking in a no-smoking area outside a hospital building, and the offence of failing to comply with signage requirements at entrances to hospital buildings regarding the no-smoking area outside those buildings. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 21st of June 2022 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. We will have an evidence session with the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport and Sporting Official on the instrument, and once we've had questions answered, we will have the formal debate on the motion. I welcome now to the committee, welcome again, Marie Todd, the Minister, and accompanying the Minister online, Jules Goodlett-Rowley, the Head of Healthy Living Unit at the Scottish Government. And I would invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement. Minister.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me here to discuss these regulations that make supplementary provision to the legislation that creates the no smoking perimeter around hospital buildings. Today I seek your agreement to giving designated officers of local authorities the power to issue fixed penalty notices in respect of two new offences relating to the ban on smoking outside hospital buildings. There are three new offences relating to this ban. Without this SSI, local authority officers, such as environmental health officers, EHOs, will only be able to issue fixed penalty notices in respect of one of those three offences. The instrument will enable local authority officers to issue fixed penalty notices in respect of the two other offences as well. As previously noted by this committee, the prohibition on smoking outside hospital buildings requires effective enforcement to ensure compliance, especially during the introduction of the 15-metre boundary. It was the intention that local authority officers would lead on the enforcement of the ban, much like they led on the enforcement of the indoor smoking ban. And as drafted, however, the provisions for the enforcement of the ban do not fully reflect that intention. This issue was only identified after the prohibition of smoking outside hospital buildings, Scotland Regulations 2022, were made earlier this year. The ban on smoking outside hospital buildings will come into force on the 5th of September 22. On this date, Section 20 of the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Act 2016 will amend the Smoking, Health and Social Care Scotland Act 2005. The 2022 regulations will also come into force. The 2005 Act, once amended, will contain three new offences relating to the ban. These offences are knowingly permitting people to smoke in the no smoking area, smoking within the no smoking area, and failing to conspicuously display no smoking notices at the entrance of hospitals. The 2005 Act will also give the police and local authority officers, such as EHOs, powers to issue fixed penalty notices in respect of these offences. However, only the police will have power to issue fixed penalty notices in respect of all three offences. EHOs will only have the power to issue fixed penalty notices in respect of the first offence, allowing people to smoke in the no smoking area. Because the intention is to allow EHOs to lead on enforcement, it's critical that EHOs can also issue fixed penalty notices in respect of the other two offences, particularly the offence of smoking in the no smoking area. Giving EHOs this power will ensure effective enforcement of the perimeter ban. Hospitals should, I'm sure we'll all agree, be places of health promotion where healthy ways of living are demonstrated. They should be environments within which people are protected from harm and supported in making positive lifestyle choices. The sight of people congregating near doorways to smoke outside our hospitals is incongruous to this. The no smoking perimeter will reduce the risk of exposure to secondhand smoke near entrances and windows. It will prevent smoke drifting into hospital buildings and it will protect those using hospitals, particularly the vulnerable. These regulations, which we are discussing today, will help deliver the effective enforcement of this ban that committee members called for during the passage of the prohibition of smoking outside hospital buildings, Scotland Regulations 2022, earlier this year. It provides local authority officers with the same enforcement powers granted to Police Scotland, who have indicated that it would be operationally difficult for them to be solely responsible for enforcement. This is a team effort. We've been working with health boards, local authorities, Police Scotland and others to bring this to fruition. Without these additional powers, we're limiting the effectiveness of the restrictions before they have even come into force. So I urge you to pass this instrument and help us to stop smoking near Scotland's hospitals. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Can I invite any questions from committee on the issue? Dr. Gohani.
Thank you, Minister. I am obviously, as a doctor, very supportive of the idea of not smoking around hospitals and around entrances. And I've actually seen people smoking outside the Children's Hospital in Glasgow with the smoke going up to the children up there. I have a few questions. And my first one, in Forth Valley, they have been trying to enforce a no smoking area, and they've got big cross hatches. They've got somebody that goes around and tells people not to smoke, and that person gets an awful lot of abuse. I understand that we're allowing environmental health officers to issue these penalties, but how do we prevent this abuse?
So that is a challenge in healthcare environments across the board. I think it's really important that we think about the cultural impact of legislation like this. When it gives clarity and certainty to people in Scotland. People in Scotland will know that hospitals are not allowing smoking in the perimeter. And I think that alone will reduce the level of conflict in implementing the ban. We heard, you know, there was a lot of concern in advance of the smoking ban around how would it be implemented and how, you know, when we had no smoking areas before the smoking ban, there was often friction around how that was implemented. And actually the smoking ban brought clarity to the situation, and people know that they're not allowed to smoke there. They know that there will be consequences if they smoke. It's not simply appealing to their good nature. There is the potential for issuing a fine should they not comply with the legislation. And I think that brings clarity and will reduce conflict, if I'm honest.
Thank you. And could I ask you to, for clarity for everyone, to define smoking? So does, obviously cigarettes is smoking, but does that include heated tobacco? Does it include vaping? Some people would say there's no nicotine in their vape, so they should be allowed to do it. So could I just get some clarity on that, please?
So the use of nicotine vapour products is not affected by these regulations. We don't have the power to include MVPs within these regulations because they weren't included in the 2016 Act. The permitting of MVP use within this perimeter and on hospital grounds will continue to be at the discretion of each health board. And I know that that is likely to lead to a lack of clarity. At the moment, the evidence on safety or otherwise of secondhand exposure to vapes is not yet clear. I am deeply cynical. So I think that vapes are a useful tool for smoking cessation, potentially. They are likely to be less harmful than smoking tobacco. But I am deeply cynical about the efforts of tobacco companies to market them widely and to ensure that they find a replacement market for the reduction in smoking. And I think we need to go very carefully with our use of vaping products in health promotion, frankly. So I wouldn't rule out looking at vaping products should the evidence firm up that exposure to secondhand vapes is problematic. I wouldn't rule out including that or considering future legislation on that. It sounds to me like it would require new primary legislation, given the 2016 Act doesn't give us the ability to regulate thus far.
Sorry, Minister, just one final question, just on vaping, and I agree. I feel that it can be quite an effective tool to help in the cessation of cigarette smoking, and it probably has a significantly lower risk than smoking, but when I walk into a hospital, anywhere, to be honest, but especially a hospital, I don't particularly want to be faced with a cloud of cherry-smelling, whatever-smelling cloud, which is what happens in a vape. And I would urge you, even though there might not be evidence about secondhand harm, I would urge you to look at vaping and include that in the bill so that we have absolute clarity that you cannot smoke at all around a hospital.
So I'm certainly willing to take on board your view on that, and we'll be looking at some issues around vaping. We've had a consultation around the regulation of vaping, and we'll be looking at some of those issues later in the year. I'm willing to take on board your view on that, but it would, as I understand it, and perhaps Jules will come in here, as I understand it, it would require primary legislation, because the original Act, which has allowed me to bring this SSI before you, did not include vaping. So it would require us to look at primary legislation on vaping, and that's an altogether larger task, but I'm certainly willing to keep it on the radar and include it should that opportunity arise in future. I think because the evidence isn't, you know, and all of our legislation, we try hard to make it evidence-based. I think because the evidence around secondhand harm from secondhand vaping isn't particularly solid yet or clear yet, I think it would be hard to introduce primary legislation on that front right now. But I'll ask if Jules has anything further to add on that. She's more familiar with the original 2016 Act.
Thank you. Yes, at the moment we don't have the powers to regulate MVPs within the regulations, and the permitting of MVPs use within the perimeter and within hospital grounds will continue to be at the discretion of each health board.
Thank you.
In a perfect world, we'd have foreseen this technology when we wrote that original piece of legislation.
Okay, thank you for that helpful exchange. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning again, Minister. I remember one of the anaesthetists telling me she was waking up from a tonsillectomy surgery, and where people smoked, it was right under the windows of the ENT ward, and she remembers waking up from her anaesthesia fog smelling of cigarette smoke. So I welcome this. I'm the co-convener of the Lung Health Cross-Party Group and a nurse, and I'm keen to hear what is being done or what measures are taking place to help health boards, local authorities, health and social care partnerships to educate people about this particular legislation so that it is easier to enforce it as we move forward.
So I would have to say I think you're absolutely right to talk about how smoke drifts in to hospital buildings from outside. I worked for 20 years as a hospital pharmacist, and I also have asthma, and I am one of those people in the workforce who would wheeze as I accessed areas of my workplace where smoke was actually, we had air conditioning that literally pulled the smoke in from the smoking area and pumped it into the ward. And that's not an unusual situation. And we need to think about the exposure to secondhand smoke that causes for staff, it causes for patients accessing care, and it causes for everyone who's visiting the hospital. That's why I think this is a really important measure. In terms of raising the profile, I think that, it's a busy news day today, I think, but I suspect that that this will make the news when it is introduced. I would expect it to be covered by our national news outlets. I would also expect the signage at hospitals to be very clear. I think that two-week run-in, which was not our intention, that gives a little bit of time for awareness to be raised about the change in smoking around hospitals before people face fines for breaking the rules. And I think that that's probably a helpful thing. So I would like to hope that there will be absolute clarity to everyone that hospitals are not places where you can smoke near to.
Can you just confirm again what the go-live date is for this? Was it September 8th, you said?
I think it is the 5th of September, and it's 2 weeks later, about the 20th of September, that the that this SSI will mean that environmental health officers can use fixed penalty notices.
OK, thanks.
Thank you. I wonder if I can ask Minister very briefly on the financial effects, and I've asked this question before to the Cabinet Secretary around the funding for environmental health to carry out this. Now, I appreciate that in the financial effects paragraph it states that local authorities are already funded to undertake tobacco work. I suppose maybe just looking for an assurance that if there were costs that they were exorbitant or added pressures for particular departments, because I'm conscious that in the City of Edinburgh and the City of Glasgow, for example, there will be a higher number of hospitals than there might be in other local authority areas. So therefore, perhaps a corresponding pressure on those teams, that will be monitored by government and that any adjustments be made if they're required.
So absolutely, I would expect this to be an effective instrument in terms of preventing the problem. But you're right, if there are financial costs arising that haven't been predicted, then we'd be more than happy to hear from local authorities. And I would have to say, as a Highlander, whilst Edinburgh may have more hospitals, there'd be a lot more travelling distance involved in monitoring the hospitals in Highlands and Islands. These are just the challenges that our local authorities and our health boards face.
Thank you. And that's very fair. And good of the Minister to remind me of my central belt bias, which often accidentally slips out. If there are no further questions, we will move to item 4 in the agenda, which is the formal debate on the MAID affirmative instrument, on which we have just taken evidence. Can I remind committee that members should not put questions to the Minister during the formal debate, and officials may not speak in the debate. So, Minister, before I invite you to move it, is there anything further you wish to say in relation to motion S6M04798?
No. Thank you.
Okay. Can I invite any contributions in the debate? Dr. Gohani.
Just to reiterate that I think it's very important that we include all products, including vaping.
Thank you. Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener. Just in response to Dr. Sandesh, I just wanted to make a wee comment about vaping as well. As someone who's given up smoking and currently vapes myself, I've got personal experience. But just statistically, we're looking at you're twice as likely to give up smoking using vaping than you are using nicotine gum. The nicotine itself is pretty harmless in that form, and you don't get the carbon monoxide, etc. as well. So I do think it's about a balance here as well, and we don't have the information and the evidence to back that up yet, but certainly the consensus across the NHS and elsewhere does seem to be that it's very, very, very much less harmful than smoking cigarettes. So on a balanced approach as well, having more people vaping, have more patients perhaps with long-term smokers actually switching to vaping could actually overall have a really, really positive impact. Thanks.
Dr. Gohani?
I agree, as in the comments that I made earlier, that I do agree that vaping has a very important potential role to play in the reduction of cigarette smoking. And I don't know many things that could be worse than cigarette smoking when it comes to harm, quite frankly. And we know that vaping is going to have less harm. But I think the point that I'm trying to raise is if you look at a lot of vaping, it does produce a big cloud of smoke. Now, you might not be one of the people that does that, but if I'm walking up to a hospital or through hospital doors or in a ground, what I don't really want to be faced with is that big plume of smoke, which, even though we don't have a lot of evidence, I just don't think that I would like to be walking through that. If everyone is outside the entrances vaping, that is just absolutely not what I'd like to see. And I think that we could, again, have the balance. We heard from the Minister that we can't put it in because it needs primary legislation, and that's absolutely fair enough. But it's a look, it's a way of ensuring that there's clarity that you don't smoke on hospital grounds, and that I just don't want to be walking through clouds of smoke.
Thank you. Are there any further contributions to debate? Would the Minister like to sum up in any respect?
I'm not sure I have much to contribute in this vaping versus non-vaping debate. I mean, I think it's very clear that vaping is, for people who are choosing it as a means of smoking cessation, it is less harmful than smoking. There is absolutely no doubt about that. There are some concerns around actually the contribution to health inequalities, the attractiveness to children and young people, and there are real concerns around the role of vaping in future that I think we need to very carefully consider. The Scottish Government has a commitment to a tobacco-free generation, whereas the contrast with the government down south is that they're committed to a smoke-free generation and are actually very pro-vaping. I am at the moment quite open-minded but sceptical and cynical about the role of the tobacco industry and how these cessation aids are portrayed. So that's the Scottish Government view on vaping, and I'm content to formally move.
the SSI.
Thank you. That was my next question. So having been formally moved by the Minister, the question is that motion S6M04798 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And therefore, the motion is agreed to. So thank you. And that concludes consideration of the instrument. I'd like to thank the Minister and indeed both of our officials for attending today. Thank you. Okay. The fifth item on our agenda then is consideration of two negative instruments which were laid on Thursday the 16th of June and came into force on the same day. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered these instruments at its meeting this morning. The committee decided to draw these instruments to the attention of the Parliament under reporting ground J for failure to comply with the laying requirements in section 28, brackets 2 of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010. However, the committee is content with the explanation provided by the Scottish Government for failure to comply with the laying requirements. The first instrument is the National Health Service Changes to Overseas Visitors Scotland Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2022. This instrument amends Part 1 and 2 of Schedule 1 of the Public Health etc. Scotland Act 2008 to add monkeypox to the list of notifiable diseases and to add monkeypox virus to the list of notifiable organisms. It ensures that certain NHS services for any overseas visitor who requires diagnosis or treatment for monkeypox are provided without charge to that overseas visitor. No motions to annul have been received in relation to the instrument. Does any member have a comment? No. I propose, therefore, that committee does not take any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No. The second instrument is the National Health Service Changes to Overseas Visitors Scotland Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2022. These regulations will trigger duties on registered medical practitioners to share information with health boards where they have reasonable grounds to suspect that a person they are attending to has monkeypox. This information must then be shared onwards to the Common Services Agency and Public Health Scotland. The regulations will also have the effect, if monkeypox virus is identified by a diagnostic laboratory in Scotland, that the director of that laboratory must provide information to the health board in the laboratory's area and to the Common Services Agency and Public Health Scotland. No motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Are there any comments? No. I propose, therefore, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No. Thank you very much. This is the final meeting of the committee ahead of the summer recess. Further details of the next meeting will be published towards the end of August. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.